Hi, I'm Rick Emerson. They are two words synonymous with the Pacific Northwest, Ken Kesey. Today we'll talk to the man who's written the new biography of this literary legend. That's when Outlook Portland begins right now on Northwest 32 TV. Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. Once upon a time, there was a boy living in a town he hated with a family he didn't much care for. The boy spent his days trapped at a Catholic school, raising the ire of priests, nuns, teachers, and elders of all varieties. And the boy spent his nights at home, flinching at the sounds of raised voices and broken glass, and sometimes worse. Accompanying all of this was the smothering, airless gloom of isolation, the certainty that no one anywhere had ever felt quite so alone, and the certainty and realization that no one would ever teach him how to escape this place. Then when he was around 13, taken to visit relatives in Markham, Oregon, the boy stopped at a roadside flea market with his parents, and there he bought a book. It cost a quarter. The boy had never heard of the book, but he bought it anyway. And then over the next day or so, the boy inhaled, he devoured every sparkling, profane, life-loving word of it. And the boy discovered something amazing, that he was not alone after all. It is no exaggeration to say that One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest changed my life. It certainly changed the life of its author, a mercurial and layered and textured and often confounding man named Ken Kesey. Joining me now to my immediate right is Mr. Mark Christensen. He is the author of Acid Christ, Ken Kesey, LSD, and the Politics of Ecstasy. Welcome to Outlook Portland, sir. How are you?
Good. I'm glad to be here.
Your life intersected with Ken Kesey's in a way that differs from most biographers in the subject.
You actually had
a personal intersection. When did you first encounter him?
I first encountered him when I was probably about 26 or 27. I was a young journalist, and I grew up in Portland, down the road, so to speak, from where he grew up in Eugene. And I encountered him at a thing called the Poetic Hua, which was his sort of circus extravaganza in celebration of American poetry. And he had William Burroughs there. He was going to have Norman Mailer there, but Mailer decided not to come because he thought Kesey had made an anti-Semitic slight to his son. Stuart Brand was there. Paul Krasner was there. There was all the electric lights of the 60s. The heavyweights of the 60s counterculture, and some of these guys by this time were going a little thin on top and all that stuff. But nevertheless, it was pretty neat.
So you were already a writer at that point.
Yeah, I was a writer. Yeah, I had a magazine. I was the editor of a magazine, a Portland magazine called $1 of all things.
What had drawn you to Kesey? You were probably familiar with his work before that.
Well, I was drawn to him because when I was a kid growing up in Raleigh Hills, we lived in this sort of upper middle class 50s 9-to-5 world and everything, in which there was a lot of money around. That was nice, and the Portland Golf Club was nice and all that stuff. But something was missing. Something, Rick, was missing, and I picked up, when I was about 14, sort of like you, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. But my take on it was different. I rooted for Big Nurse. I mean, here was this kind of hot-looking chick, nice, shapely and all that stuff, in this insane asylum with all these lunatics led by this main madman, Randall P. McMurphy, and all she had was two black kids and a bunch of hypodermic needles to protect her and keep her safe. And so I was, when I was 14, we had some issues at home that were related to that kind of stuff too. So I kind of got it backwards, maybe. I don't know.
When you sat down to write this autobiography, were there myths that you were trying to deconstruct, or were you, I'll hear people say that they wrote a biography because they themselves wanted to know more, and the book didn't exist, and so they had no choice but to write it themselves.
That's sort of first cousin to my experience. What happened is, about 3 years ago, I just got a call from a publisher who said, I got an idea for a different way to do a biography. I want to do a biography of a major 20th century cultural figure from the point of view of somebody whose life he changed, mm-hmm. namely yours. I was the one who got picked. And I go, well, in my book, that would have to be, no pun intended, that would have to be Ken Kesey. Because here's a guy that, for good or ill, turned American culture on its head. He had a lot of help from Tim Leary and a few other guys. But I mean, he was of the belief that LSD, if you took it, would, if not turn you into Nietzsche's Superman, at least allow you to hallucinate your rent check, you know? He went out and for millions of baby boomers like me, I mean, he literally flipped the world upside down.
There's a lot to get to here, and we'll definitely touch on the issue of Kesey's drug intake, his massive drug consumption in a bit. I wanted to ask you something that I've seen this before, and I've never quite been able to suss out the difference between an authorized biography and an unauthorized biography. And
nothing was authorized about this. I mean, we had more legal. This thing has been vetted by everybody from J. Edgar Hoover on down.
That's the estate. Then does somebody have to look at it and say either we approve, we sign off, or we don't? Is that the difference?
No, it just gets down to lawyers versus lawyers. And I will say, at the very top, Ken Kesey's widow, Faye, as far as I know, is very nice. It was all the creatures around that whole circus. You know, as I've said before, even dead dope dealers have attorneys. You know, and there was this is not an authorized biography.
You're watching Outlook Portland right here on Northwest 32 TV. We're talking with Mr. Mark Christensen, the author of Acid Christ, Ken Kesey, LSD, and the Politics of Ecstasy. We return right after this. Hey, I'm Rick Emerson. Do any of these things sound familiar? Musical neckties, giant overpriced tubs of popcorn, or perhaps a gift certificate to the Gas and Go with a note saying, buy yourself something nice. If so, you may have been the recipient of a terrible holiday present, a present from that guy. The cure for that guy's present is a trip to things from another world. You can go there, you can find everything under the sun and a few things beyond the sun on the subject of comic books, graphic novels, games, toys, collectibles, clothing, and more. It is geekology personified, and most importantly to you, humble viewer, they are the marquee sponsor of this very fine television program. Outlook Portland. Things from Another World has four physical locations in Portland. You can also find them online at tfaw.com. tfaw.com. Things from Another World. Whatever you're into, they have just the thing for your collection.